Good morning, good afternoon, whatever time you're watching, thank you. I'm Alastair Macaulay, talking for the Oxford Dansox Wonderful Society, talking today about Paul Taylor. It's great looking at this image of the summer school here. I hope you recognize that the pictorial image on left and right is, I think, taken from the original 1913 Rite of Spring, The Chosen Maiden. I hope I've got that right. Nice connection, because the very first meeting of Dansox was about the Rite of Spring, with Jane Pritchard talking about the Diaghilev-Nijinsky original. I remember sitting up in that balcony there. But there's a connection to today, because Paul Taylor choreographed his own Rite of Spring, Le Sacre, the rehearsal. We'll come to that later on. And I particularly like to pay tribute to wonderful Susan Jones, who is a constant figure behind Dansox, who has made it a home of scholarship and research and analysis of dance within Britain at a time when that is being cut back from everywhere else in British dance education. My thanks, my congratulations. Paul Taylor, born 1930, died 2018. I so well remember roughly this time of year, 2 years ago, having to work on his obituary in the final weeks of his life. I hate writing obituaries during people's lifetimes, but in newspapers you're often obliged to do so. And we knew at the age of 88 that he was going. He's a really central figure in the history of American modern dance. He and his company danced here from about 1964, I think, onwards, over more than 50 years visits here. The company is going after his death. On tour, it tends to be called the Paul Taylor Dance Company, but it was his vision at the end of his life to rename it for its big, pivotal New York annual seasons as Paul Taylor's American Modern Dance. Please notice the apostrophe S, Paul Taylor's apostrophe American Modern Dance. That seemed a little too proprietorial after a season or two, and during his lifetime it came relabeled as Paul Taylor American Modern Dance. The connection is fascinating, because during his lifetime, early on, Paul Taylor started to become what seemed the mainstream of American modern dance. He looped in so many threads and made it a tradition. He received and others took from him. On the way up in the early 50s, as a student at Juilliard, he trained with Doris Humphrey, with José Limón, with the great music theorist and dance critic Louis Horst, and also from the great ballet choreographer and teacher Anthony Tudor, from whom he learnt so much about how dances could be made. No sooner did he leave Juilliard than he danced with Merce Cunningham, then way out beyond the furthest out. After spending about half a year, he was in the founding company of Merce Cunningham at Black Mountain in 1953. He danced with the company until January 1954, its first New York season at the Théâtre de Lys. Then he joined the Martha Graham Company, where he was for some 8 or so years, dancing in such central Graham works as the full-length Clytemnestra. During that period, he worked once with Balanchine. George Balanchine and Martha Graham had become, in the 50s, the leading lights of American choreography, and influences to whom all other choreographers, not only in America, referred and derived. From Balanchine, well, the two worked came together in 1959 on a project called Episodes, working at New York City Center, which was the home of Balanchine's New York City Ballet at that time. But they both came together to work on episodes both using music by Webern. Whenever Martha Graham got stuck or had a problem or needed more music, Balanchine would give up some more Webern music, and he was practical. He just would work with whatever she wasn't using, which was nonetheless some of Webern's finest music. But Webern is, of course, even decades after his death, advanced modernist music. Here were the two master modernists of choreography at that time, using the same music to very different ends. Graham, by this point, very much an expressionist. She made episodes about the combat between Elizabeth I of England and Mary Queen of Scots. Balanchine made his in terms of pure dance, what was widely known as the abstract, though I debate whether any dance can ever be called abstract. And they had the premise or gimmick that each one would take one dancer from the other one's company. And Graham took a dancer called Sally Wilson from New York City Ballet to play the role of Elizabeth opposite her own Mary Queen of Scots. Balanchine took one man from the Graham company, Paul Taylor, and he made a solo that was like nothing else, which has been reconstructed. Taylor himself reconstructed it after Balanchine's death, and at the end of Taylor's life, he helped to put it together again for, I think, a revival by Miami City Ballet of the Balanchine episodes, and it's been revived by the Paul Taylor Company. So Taylor was learning from all the masters. He also began to work with two of the greatest American visual artists at the time, from 1954 to 1962. He worked with the young Robert Rauschenberg before he was a big name. And then he began also to work with the great figurative artist Alex Katz, who became a colleague with whom he made the odd piece through to the end of his life, one of the great colorists of American modernism. From the early 1960s onwards, when Taylor started to have a more permanent company of his own, some of the most important choreographers of our time came out of his company. The two most famous are Pina Bausch and Twyla Tharp, somebody who's not often enough talked about in a Paul Taylor context is the choreographer Mark Morris. And some studies of Mark Morris rush over the connection between the two. Actually, it was big, and Mark Morris longed to join the Paul Taylor company when he was a young dancer in New York in the early 1980s. And if you look at such works as Gloria and Stabat Mater, even V made decades later, you can see that Mark Morris is deriving movement ideas and often musical ideas from Paul Taylor's choreography, above all from Paul Taylor's masterwork of all masterworks, Esplanade. When I came along in the 1980s, Paul Taylor was so much a success that he would have an annual season of 3 or 4 weeks at New York City Center, one of New York's 3 or 4 largest theaters, opera house scale, with his own orchestra, one of the great events of the dance year in New York. And Paul Taylor, American Modern Dance Today, performs with orchestra and has for the last, I think, 10, 12 years, what's now the New York State, what was the New York State Theater. It's been renamed, and I hate its name because it's named after a Republican beast, but at Lincoln Center. During this period, Taylor became the tradition of modern dance, the orthodoxy, the mainstream. That's one side of him, and I want to put it in opposition today with the other side of him, which is deeply unorthodox, perverse, even unpredictable, challenging. Certainly he was a master. Many of his greatest masterpieces had the oddest ideas within them, and it's fascinating how the two sides of his brain coalesce. Perhaps I shouldn't talk of two sides. When I think of Taylor, I often refer to the great American literary critic, Edmund Wilson, who wrote a book called The Triple Thinkers. He studies Henry James, Pushkin, the whole tradition of Marxism and literature, Hausmann, Flaubert, and others. And he's talking about how these great artists are making works that work on several different levels at the same time. Sure, they're telling stories, but there are ambiguities within their stories. Then they are formal structure artists at the same time, and how these different, very different elements of the mind work together to make their works of art. We must never just think that any work of art by these men is just doing one thing. That's true, I think, of all the great choreographers, but with Taylor, the different areas of the mind seem so distanced from each other that it always staggers me. We're talking of a master of ambiguity and of multiplicity. It particularly applies, I think, when we're talking about musicality. Now, with musicality, we're talking about the hardest thing in dance to analyze. Remember that Taylor began his professional career as a dancer with Merce Cunningham, who, of course, just at this point, 1953 or so, was starting to make muses independent, to make dances independent of music. Taylor was in some of the ones that were still to music. He was in the original cast, 1953, of Cunningham's Septet, made to Eric Satie. And what's fascinating about Septet, which is still performed, and you can find it on video too, is that it shows that Cunningham is listening to the Satie music. He is not responding to every level of the music. So that, say, in the opening dance of Septet, sometimes you see him responding to aspects of the harmony and the melody, and yet there are sudden staccato, macchiato chords that Cunningham seems to let breeze over the dance without him making any movement in response to them. From this onwards, Taylor, I think, began to learn how many layers there can be to music and musicality in choreography, and what choices a choreographer had. He left the Cunningham Company. He said in his memoirs years later that he objected to the idea of chance procedures, and that chance didn't give him enough to dance. But actually, he hung around in the Cunningham orbit for some 8 or so years. He was close to John Cage, who dedicated a piece of music to him. He was close friends with Robert Rauschenberg, and really, Rauschenberg and Cunningham and Taylor all began to work together at the same time. That is, Rauschenberg became the house designer to the Cunningham Company from 1954 onwards, but Taylor began to make individual works from exactly that time onwards, right up to 1962. With Cunningham, Rauschenberg worked longer. Through Rauschenberg, Taylor became friends with Jasper Johns. I don't think they ever worked together, but they absolutely were friends. And Taylor was making dances in this late 50s period that were highly experimentalist. And he was dancing at this point with Martha Graham, but his own works were often wacky, often minimalist, and there's one program where he looks back and says, I think really I was the inventor of dance postmodernism before it happened in the 1960s. With respect, I think that's a bit arrogant, because actually many of the minimalism aspects of Taylor's choreography really were already there from Isadora Duncan. Isadora Duncan had made a whole style at the beginning of the 20th century that was to do with walking, standing, falling, running, skipping. Basic pedestrian movement, which she had turned into the lyricism of dance. Taylor did some of the same in a completely modern way. Let's look at the only well-known work from this period, and we're just going to look at the first minute. It's not a great film, it's outdoors, but it's three epitaphs from 1956. And this is Taylor responding here to music, which he didn't always in this period. Three epitaphs, it's to jazz, early jazz music from the South, American South. Rauschenberg costumes, those odd bits of reflective glass on the head, movement, a weird mixture of slumpy posture, fast gestures, it's both brisk and weighted, it's comic, absurd, strange. Thank you. laughter to this day. It's not exclusive to the Taylor Company. I remember it danced by London Contemporary Dance Theatre in the 1980s. Okay, let's stop there. Thank you. Taylor's learning in the late 50s, both from this kind of experimentalism, from Graham, from Balanchine, from Cunningham, whose work he observed closely, and I wish we knew more about just what was going through Taylor's mind at this period. Episodes where he danced for Balanchine happened in 1959. People I knew in New York used to remember Taylor not just dancing in episodes, but being around the Balanchine audience, watching the repertory very carefully. And in his memoirs, written in the mid-80s, Private Domain, he reveals that Balanchine invited him to dance Apollo, one of the greatest works. Now, Taylor was not a ballet dancer. In fact, much of Apollo is not the role is not ballet vocabulary, but the connection between Balanchine's mind and Taylor, as if he's going to remake Apollo for him, is a fascinating idea, and it's very interesting that Taylor chose to turn that great opportunity down. He was one of the great dancers, by the way. He was a swimmer, a competition-winning swimmer, so big, broad shoulders, athletic, outgoing, with famously blue eyes that radiated throughout the theatre. I've sometimes talked about what I call the New York School of Choreography, and I think it really began in the 50s. I think that Cunningham was its first great student, and I think that Taylor was another. Now, those two men made work largely unlike what, therefore, was the school, and what did they learn, and who were its teachers? Well, Balanchine was one teacher, Graham was another. Graham making people think about expression, expressionism in dance, how movement can convey meaning, but often different kinds of ambiguous meaning. Balanchine working on so much on musicality, but actually full of romantic, modernist, strange meaning too. I think they learnt from the great dance critic Edwin Denby, who had been a highly influential writer from 1936 onwards and was friends with both Cunningham and Taylor. I think they learnt from Anthony Tudor, who'd been choreographing, the British choreographer, but he'd been choreographing in New York from 1940-41 onwards, making strange connections between existing music and the dance dramas, ballet dramas that he composed, and being a highly influential teacher of his particular brand of the Cecchetti method, principally at Juilliard. The other thing, of course, they learnt from, and I think Denby here was an influence, was New York itself, and they learnt about pedestrian movement. Graham makes her Clytemnestra, her great dance drama, in 1958. That year, the Cunningham Company, the Graham Company, and the Lamone Company all appear at the American Dance Festival at Connecticut College. It was widely said that if you loved one company, you couldn't bear the others, but the one the other all dumped on was the Cunningham Company. But I don't think Taylor could have, because that was the year that Cunningham premiered Summer Space, and after Cunningham's death, if you know anything about Cunningham's Summer Space, it has the famous pointillist backdrop by Robert Rauschenberg. Paul Taylor revealed that not only did Jasper Johns contribute some of the brushstrokes, but so did he, Paul Taylor. So he was a Graham dancer with one toe in the Cunningham camp still. In 1957, he presented a program in New York called Seven New Dancers, and it was highly controversial. One duet was set to John Cage music, and one solo was entirely Taylor standing still. It's a reflection of the famous John Cunningham composition, 4 minutes 33 of silence. Taylor is doing the dance movement equivalent. It's famous that Louis Horst wrote a review which was simply blank as a response. That way of movement at that time, of course, was controversial. Taylor made the decision to start addressing the audience, inviting the audience. And he did this above all in 1962 with a great work called Aureole, which I should be showing you today. You can see it on YouTube, set to Handel music. He wasn't the first modern dance choreographer to use Handel or Baroque music, but he did so in a lyrical way that brought out its sheer danciness that seemed the opposite of the avant-garde character that was often associated with modern dance. At the same time, he did some things that nobody else in modern dance was doing. He made a solo for himself that was adagio, flowing, a lot of it on one leg, just going from one position to another, and the way that the phrasing took him in this solo echoed currents in the music, elements of musical phrasing, and this kind of musicality, not what necessarily anybody associated with Handel music, but nonetheless deeply responsive, was a breakthrough. Breakthrough of more than one kind, because though it was a big hit and it put Taylor immediately on the map and made him popular everywhere, his closest avant-garde friends could not bear it because he seemed to be inviting, courting popularity. They didn't mind that being success, but they wanted success thrust upon them. He seemed to be going out there to ask for it. And so Robert Rauschenberg never worked with him again. Jasper Johns basically became an ex-friend, and John Cage, I think, more of an enemy yet. In case you're curious, I think Merce Cunningham always remained courteous to Paul Taylor. And there are odd notes of that have come up in the archives now of Cunningham saying, "I went to see such and such of your works, Paul, your dancers are so beautiful, etc." Love, Merce. So not total enmity on all parts. Okay, let's, instead of Aureole, look at various different works that Taylor made to Baroque music. And the first of them, and I'm going to return to this, is the great masterpiece Esplanade, made in 1975. One of the interesting things about this is that Taylor had been injured in his early 40s and he'd stopped dancing in 1974. For many choreographers in modern dance, choreography is about them. It's a vehicle for their dancing, and everybody else is some kind of wonderful supporting act. Taylor had been a great dancer, yet he stops dancing in 74, he makes Esplanade, it is his most fabulous piece of all. And he goes back to this idea that maybe postmodern, it may be Isadora, of basic human pedestrian movement. There is not one formal academic step in Esplanade. It's walking, running, jumping, falling, blah, blah. That all seems natural, it seems inevitable. Actually, it's a highly ceremonious, contrived, structured work. Let's just look at the first movement. It's filmed, you can find it on YouTube. It's, I think, seeing the first cast, 1975. To Bach violin concertos. Dancers seemed pretty orthodox step number. Only gradually you start to notice that it's three men and five women. So there's a little irregularity. What is that going to do? How is that going to work out? Esplanade is in five movements. The first three are from one violin concerto. The fourth and fifth movements are from the famous concerto for two violins or double violins. You see straight away her natural movement becomes organized. She moves one way, she moves the other, she changes directions. And it feels like the workings of the human heart, but actually it's highly organized. The chain dance, going back to the Greeks or the idea of the farandole. Gesture, walk, gesture, this direction, that direction, that gesture leaning over to see again. its system of isolated gestures that seem unconnected to anything is something that I think Taylor learned from Balanchine, and they become motifs. We will see those gestures again. Come forward, turn, walk sideways, walk backwards, changes of direction. We don't quite know what's impulsive, what's natural, and what is highly planned. But I think those sudden turns give us a feeling of impulsiveness, of youth. That sudden way when you're young, you're doing one thing and then you have to do another. But you also see the sense of ceremony and running. Discovering what Isadora had been about. She could run, to use Frederick Ashton's word, and leave herself behind. Gesture, fragmented gesture, so balanced. And yet, it doesn't feel like balancing. It's only balancing when you think about it. Walking that way, turning 90 degrees, 90 degrees, 90 degrees. Now they're in the column breaks. One gesture turns into a chain, linking the arms. Isolated people become a community. One lone dancer comes in, dances with all of them watching. Here's the most famous single image in all of Astaire, Pop. The turns of the head as they look at it. Faithfulness itself. And if you're at this point thinking this is all a bit damn sweet, there is that where she runs as if, hey, wait for me. And this is going to be a work also that contains a lot of darkness as well as joy. Now all this multi-directional movement makes us wonder what's going on. Way to use a violin cadenza. The music is slowing and stopping. Chain goes around. How is it going to complete? Slight difference. He touches her ankle just as the violin lowers itself. Now the chain becomes the circle. And we're off. Morris's L'Allegro, Penseroso, and Moderato should recognize those central circles with another ring around it. Men left, women right, three dancing for five. And from this, and from many other Taylor dances, we get the idea of real heteronormative movement. A grist to it, a grit in the oyster, because there's three and there's five. How are they going to match? And I've used the word heteronormative, and we're going to see a work that actually challenges that. I mean, Esplanade itself challenges that, but not in this first movement. Now they move into four and four, and we hardly notice that it's been done. Last girl who joins the boys. quite a lot of this first movement is to do with retrograde and walking backwards, doing everything backwards that was just being done forwards. It happens so inevitably that we don't analyze it, but it's there. Sideways stop, turn the other way, stop. He stops and starts. Catch the heart. I love the way when just they're running towards the front there, it's not just a straight run, it's a rhythmically accentuated run. We'll return to Esplanade, two other movements. I want to look at each of them separately. But now we're going to go on just the very next year, Cloven Kingdom, 1976. This is one of the oddest dances ever made. It's the one that, one of the two that I go back to in my mind above all when I call Taylor a triple thinker. It's also one of the greatest dances ever made. In the program, and Taylor often loves a program note, but he really puts in a program note as a compositional idea to help the audience think, not to say what it's about, but he simply quotes from Spinoza, and he loves quotations. Spinoza, the philosopher, as just says, man is a social animal. And really, Cloven Kingdom is almost a joke about how an animal can be social and how a human can be an animal and all of those things. Let's just look at the beginning of the first movement. But I should say it's to three different composers. Corelli from the 18th, 17th century, and to two modernist composers, Henry Cowell and Molloy Miller. How do you combine the three? Let's look. All with it at the beginning. In long dresses that seem formal. And just as you're thinking, oh, it's ceremonious again, you see that surprising movement from these two women on the left. What is going on? Other music gently underneath. I'm sure Taylor was also thinking of the famous line from Thoreau, some men have a different drummer. Some are dancing to some music, others are hearing some other kind of rhythm. And this strange musicality really makes Cloven Kingdom, I think, one of the most profound works about the human condition. We exist on many levels, but we coexist on them. I'd like to thank Michael Novak of the Paul Taylor Company, who's now its artistic director. He was named as such by Taylor. He very kindly has allowed me for this lecture to show these films from the Taylor archive. Now here are the four men entering in white tie. formal dinner attire. What the hell is going on? What I'm not going to show you is the great formal quartet for those men. It's one of the knockout dances of any modern dance repertory, where they get going with such furious energy. This is just a little introduction to it. Okay, let's stop here. Thank you. And let's go on to the next part. This is right in the middle of Cloven Kingdom, and we'll start to see how strange this piece is once it gets going. One thing, look at how these women are dressed. Taylor had strong ideas on costuming. They're still wearing those dresses, but look at this space age helmeting. I think it makes them seem like high priestesses of some cult that we cannot fully understand. And the way they exist with each other, completely serene in their strange behavior, makes them seem as if they are in touch with something way beyond our ordinary human social condition. You will notice that staccato gesture to know music that we can hear. Again. And now we're really seeing social dance, men and women. On different levels. Women dancing tough and strong, men echoing it. They're not the ones who set the example in terms of higher energy and aggressive strength. And these different elements of the nature, the human nature, come and go. In a way, you don't get Taylor unless you see him as a great dramatic poet. And by dramatic, I don't necessarily mean narrative, but the idea of drama, as with Cunningham, as with Graham, as with Balanchine, is always there. When I first saw this, I saw it done by London Contemporary Dance Theatre, I think in 1980. And I remember thinking, this is meant to be musical, it's anti-musical, I couldn't bear it. And then I went to see the Taylor Company for the first time, 1987, in Paris. And the first work they were doing was Cloven Kingdom, and I got the musicality straight away. And it begins, of course, as musicality of the movement itself, which here and there goes in and out of the music that we hear. you're beginning to sense the tailor style and technique here. It is so various that it's terrible to generalize about it all. But very roughly, very approximately, I would say that the tailor style or technique is closely related to the Arthur Graham one. It's really just that the dynamics are very different. Tailor style has a lyricism and a flow, or can have, that we don't find generally in Graham. Okay, let's stop here. Thank you. We'll go into a third work to Baroque music, Handel again. This is one that Taylor made also in the 70s, 1978. It's called Airs. It's been done by a number of ballet companies. You'll see why. But you'll also see, I think, particularly since we're watching it with the Taylor dancers, as to what's different about the Taylor accentuation. We're going to see two sections from Airs. We'll come to the other one later on. But the first one, I think, has the most Petipa-type step, Marius Petipa, 19th century, blah, blah, and you know who he is, which is going from the feet together, développé into penché. I'm too old to demonstrate this, but very roughly. Turns and goes down into penché. It's a very Petipa type way of presenting the body, going through more than one angle as the body moves. Wonderful in its sense of the progress of a single shape. You'll see it in the heteronormative context, and yet Michelle Fleet dances it as if she's completely independent of the men for whom she is dancing. Is she dancing for men? Is she just dancing in a context where they are watching, but she has her own life, her own purpose? Let's look. Again, a recent performance. Is like one we saw in Cloven Kingdom. Here's the développé I'm talking about. Push down into penché. Now you often see that kind of movement in ballet, but here we really sense the whole sense of flow through the calf, the thigh, the leg, the torso. In ballet, Aurora dances with four suitors rather than three in the Rose Adagio. The sense of ceremony between them, though, is related to what we see here. But she is independent. It's a sense of chivalry, courtesy. But quite what the society is, we never know. Nobody in the Rose Adagio goes down to the floor like these men. And she goes on completing the phrase for its own sake, and they process around her. Women who were dancing with her before the men entered now return. And this idea of a septet is something that we will see again when we return to Ayres. Taylor knows so many things to do. Okay, let's end that. Thank you. Now let's go on to a work made in 1988. I actually reviewed the world premiere when I was working in New York for the New Yorker. It's Brandenburg's, made to, guess what, movements from Bach's Brandenburg Concerti. And we're going to look at the last two movements, very different aspects of Taylor. One is just a male dancer. Originally it was Christopher Gillis. Here we're going to see the great Michael Trusnovich. Not that Christopher Gillis was anything less than great, great, great. He dances himself to the kind of adagio that I described in Oriole, and then we're going to see all the company dancing in the fast final movement. Let's go. Again, a recent film, Klosovich actually retired from dancing. This last. So you see straight away, you hear straight away how Taylor picks up on phrasing and music. He's going for the legato flow of that violin. Giving you extraordinary three-dimensional changing sculptural shapes. Hard really to analyze the rhythm of it, very easy to feel the flow. And I think what you also start to feel is the harmony. This three-dimensional complexity of the body picks up on tension within Bach's music. We don't know when a phrase begins or ends, and Bach is making us feel the same with this violin phrase. But that's the end of the movement, and on comes everybody else. These three women have been that leading man's main co-stars in this work. You see a structure of one man, three women, five men. Interesting organization. I think Taylor learned from Balanchine about how to play with numbers, how to have irregular numbers of men and women fitting together. That straight away creates drama and suspense. And you see how Taylor here is making rhythm from changes of angle in the body, changes of direction. Sometimes just get all long. It is a change of direction for the body, this way, that way. And now, of course, we're very keenly aware of another kind of musicality, because Taylor's rhythm is extremely strong when he wants to give you a pulse. These women establishing now a sense of a perpetuum mobile. Spin, 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 spin. Not just women. Keeping the rhythm going, but now with gesture and change of angle. Yet in terms of movement, you never get stuck into one rhythmic groove. They're making different kinds of rhythm as the dance proceeds in different parts of the body and stage. Look at him spinning now with the arms out. This open gesture we're ready to see. I find for myself that one of the things that makes me most simply happy in dance is if somebody turns to the left and then turns to the right. It makes the dancer seem so much more capable of variety, and I notice that Taylor so often, just as he gives you one kind of spinning, then will give you a reversal. By the way, the dark hair dancer we just saw here is wonderful Parisa Cobde, who of course is one of our lecturers for the summer school, now living in London. Just left the Taylor Company last year. Not just one of his greatest dancers, but in his final years, certainly his most versatile. It's actually becoming faster and more complex in terms of what the dancers are doing with those extra hops now. Now the momentum space is taking off in a new way. The more you analyze it, the more there is to see. You think you're just seeing a repetition of a step, but that never lasts so long. There's Parisa in the middle. Already, you start to see how many things Taylor can do with geometry. Very often it's, as you see here, orthodox geometry, symmetrical. But how wacky did all the symmetry suddenly to get that rocking step in leg to leg. Didn't expect is a diagonal and that powder. Okay, wonderful to see that again. That's an interesting, rare example of a work that Taylor revised. Actually, I review the 1988 premiere, but in 1989 he made certain changes to it. I've never quite been able to analyze what they are. They include costuming, and it's that revised version that's been danced ever since. And it made it a bigger hit. Let's now go back to Esplanade. And I too can be perverse. I ought to give you the second movement, shouldn't I? But no, I'm going to go straight this time for the finale. Again, natural movement. We're going to begin with running, falling, twirling, and then rolls across the floor. You'll see the whole variety. It seems so elemental, but yet again, the choreography will show you that there is structure, pattern, synchronicity. There's one particular phenomenal solo where a woman just runs, falls, jumps, falls, falls, falls. She seems it's abandoned, and yet it also seems as if she is immolating herself. Phenomenal dramatic effect. Very briefly, there's the gesture where a woman or women get down on the floor and fold their hands down across their laps with head going back. We're going to see that again, but where have we seen it before? Well, if you know ballet, that is like the mime gesture in Swan Lake, where Odette in Swan Lake goes, I here will commit suicide. The head goes back, the arms are crossed. I don't say that Taylor is referring to Swan Lake. It's possible he's not even aware of Swan Lake, but that aspect of body language has certainly something fateful about it. We don't know what the women are referring to when this happens in Esplanade. It's just part of the flow, but it is part of the darkness that comes in as the shadow amid the joy. Another repeated motif is women simply lying on the floor, legs apart. It may be an image of death, it may be an image of childbirth, it may be an image of rest, whatever. Taylor lets it become emphatic. Let's look. Also on YouTube, by the way. There's what we saw in the first movement. Up, change of direction, turn left, turn right. There's the Odette suicide gesture. Now, all the women on the, three women rather, on the floor in the same spasmodic column. There again. And it's cropped the lap. Love what these women are doing on the floor here. It's expensive, but it's helpless. What is it that is driving them along? You could just say the music, but it's like life itself. Bang! 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 by the way, that's the motif we have seen in jumping into men's arms early in the work. You can check the second movement in. No, sorry, the third and fourth movement in. Just to left, just to right, there's that open, then just... One more left and low, then left and right, then back, then front towards us, again that gesture. End of work. Wonderful, heart-stopping piece. Okay, just to remind you that Taylor didn't only use Baroque music, we'll look at two dances to other music. I mentioned La Sacra. In 1980, he surprised everybody by making his version of The Rite of Spring. He made it to the original two-piano score, or four-hand score, which is the version to which Stravinsky and Diaghilev and Nijinsky rehearsed the original 1913 ballet. We're just going to look at the beginning, and as you look merely at the beginning, it's crazy. And if you don't know the Taylor Sacra, and he calls it La Sacra, the rehearsal, you're going to see so many different elements thinking, what is going on here? And that's what you should think. This is an exercise in suspense, and it is partly comic. It's partly a thriller. You're going to see a ballet company rehearsing, I presume the original, or an early neo-primitivist Rite of Spring. You're also going to see a story to do with crooks and to do with a private detective and a mother with a baby. How do all these things connect? Let's look. Not only do they connect, how do they connect to this famous, mysterious music? Here's the man who we will come to know as the private detective. Here, played by Michael Drusevich, original Christopher Guinness. Now, he's already a surprising beginning, but now we see a ballet company doing its own weird kind of rehearsal, warming up as if at the bar. I think is the baby in its cot now. It's been stolen. make sense to you as you're watching. It does work when you see the whole work in the theatre. We're just watching the beginning. Here are the crooks on the right. I love this way the gauze lifts. The ballet is being made. I'm going to interrupt and stop you there. I hope you see the whole work if you never have. But I will cut to the chase in one respect, that Taylor keeps up this weird ambiguity of tone. We never quite know how much we should laugh or have our hearts in our mouths. And at the end, there is something like the end of a Jacobean tragedy, where A kills B, C kills D, E kills F, and we just see them all falling over like dominoes. The mother kills the chief gangster, I think, gangster's mall, I forget. And we feel it rhythmically, and then suddenly, with an afterthought, on an extra beat, the gangster's mall, whoever she is who does it, suddenly does an extra stab to the baby. And suddenly this half cartoon work changes in a moment, because a baby has been killed, a baby that has been there since the beginning of the work. And the mother then goes into a great dance of totally violent grief that is to the famous music of The Chosen Maiden, the great climax of The Rite of Spring. And suddenly our sense of comedy vanishes for a while, even though some of the staccato-driven quality remains. We do watch with our hearts and our mouths, I think, right up to the end, thinking, how should we be responding to this? It is a very big hit. It's a triumph in the theatre. Let's move on now to very different music, also 20th century, though. I once called Taylor one of the great war poets. He must have liked it, because I noticed it going up on the ads straight away. I was particularly referring to his masterpiece, 1985, called Sunset, which is made about four men in armed services uniform, as if on leave, dancing with each other, waiting, and then with women. And you build up this, it builds up this extraordinary sense of poignancy between what women can hope for with men who are going to go back to serve in the armed forces, what, how much men want from these women, can never achieve with these women, and the fact that in some ways these men are far more bound up with each other, which may have all kinds of same-sex suggestions, and I don't mean to make it intensely sexual, but the ambiguities, the possibilities build up in our mind. There's the sense of what the men cannot, how they cannot bond with the women in the way that they can only bond with the men, and yet the sense of affection between men and women is very strong. There is, at one point, a mysterious death with the women mourning a man. The music is largely to Elgar. Strange that Taylor does this, and it seems to be about Americans, to an English Edwardian composer. And then every so often it is interrupted by the sound offstage of loons. this, again, the triple thinker, the various elements of music, musicality, drama coming in and out. But I don't have a film of Sunset to show you, and I would want to show you all of it. Instead, I'm just going to show you one excerpt near the end of his much lighter work, Company B, set to tunes by the Andrews Sisters. And Taylor was fascinated by that, the Andrews Sisters, who are mainly light, bubbly songs, a close harmony female quartet from the 1940s. But they, of course, were making their music during the Second World War, and it's for people who know about happiness at a time of distress and grief. We're going to begin with the end of one dance, which is highly sexist, heteronormative, a girl dancing for men who are effectively trying to look up her skirt. It's called Rum and Coca-Cola, the song. That gives you the bubbly, flirtatious, slightly gross sense of that period. Then we go into a very different duet, There Will Never Be Another You. I should say the Company B, though it's light and bubbly, really there's a sense that it is a memory piece, even a ghost town piece. It begins with everybody, an empty stage, and then people coming on from the wings in shadows as if they are the dead, coming back to relive their lives of the past. And in particular, the sense that the women are going over their memories of the men, and we'll see during this duet that the men, we see some men going to war, and the man in the duet joins these comrades that he is in some ways more part of than he ever is with her. And then we'll go just to the beginning of the finale, because I just adore structurally how the way Taylor connects that mood, the elegiac duet, to the finale, which is really a Broadway recapitulation. Everybody comes on doing one of the dances they did earlier on in the work, and the woman who was in the duet just sits there center stage for some time until suddenly she snaps into the dance that she was doing with three other girls. Okay, here we go. End of Company B. Men are deliberately cracks. Working for the Yankee dollar. She knows what it is to show a lot of leg. They know what it is to look for even more leg. The idea, of course, of her prancing across a chain is one we saw in Esplanade. Look at the way they're crawling after her. They don't get it. But it gives us that perkiness which we're now not going to see in this duet. I call it a duet, but in a way, it's a non-duet. I think straight away, it works best if you feel it as if she's dancing with a ghost. The lighting goes wrong there, by the way. Now it goes right again. She's trying to make a connection to a man who has already gone. Staccato, marcato qualities of movement there against the general flow of the song. And of course, the drama of the dance is picking up on the sadness in the words, which is easy to ignore amid the lyricism of the tune. Hint of her holding a baby there and then losing her. Him wanting her. Separate orbits. his torso.
But how can they come true?
Doubled over in grief there on the left. The men in the background are so clearly marching to war, even in a dance way. The most open gesture of falling as he extricates himself. Penultimate work of Company B. We won't get a look at all the finale, but I do want you to see the beginning. So beautiful is this. The song is by Mere Miss Duchesne. Please let me explain. Miss Dolly, I love you. Groups come in that we saw in each individual number. Theresa Copley on the left. These three women dance around her, and they were with her earlier on, and suddenly she's into their groove. And the transition is absolutely fluent. They were Bobby Soxers to this man who had danced the great Chico solo. Finale, but I'm going to cut off. It's so charming, but at the end they do all vanish off into the wings. It was a memory. Let's now return to Baroque music. Let's return to Airs. I'm going to show you the finale of Airs, that 1978 work made to Handel music. Again, Michel Fleet solo amid a septet. Let's see Taylor's just mastery of construction. How does one woman fit in with six others? Strange going into it out of context because, of course, they've been dancing hard, as you can tell. You don't know that. Such a gentle, quiet ending. One lone man comes on to this female quartet and takes off one woman. The most courteous exit imaginable. So tender. The three women continue. Meanwhile, another man has entered. The same courteous exit. A third man here. And as in that earlier part of Airs, Michel Fleet just continues. The dance has its own life. It's fine if men come along and are part of it, but she has her own purpose. The dance is larger than them. And actually, it includes them all. I love that Taylor use of the pelvis, by the way. So often is prepared to let the whole torso tilt sideways as the pelvis tips one way or the other. Particularly emphatic for women. She does this wonderful gesture, just rotating, heels together, and it seems to be a summoning gesture because look, first couple, second couple, and third couple, arriving into a pattern of perfect symmetry. That's the one thing we didn't expect. and then again opening of the arms. It's an ending that brings me very close to tears. There's so much to say, and there's so much to say about Taylor. I really am not showing you half of the facets that he could achieve. But instead, let's just go on to the work I've already been looking at, Esplanade. We're going to go back to the second movement, set to part of that first violin concerto. And the second movement, I think, is the greatest of all the movements of Esplanade. I've been talking about Taylor as a master of heteronormative structure, men dancing one way and women another, and what goes on between men and women. Here we see another creature who is female, but in trousers. I call her the androgyne. But she may simply be a modern woman. This is made in 1975. It may be that the rest are a more period view of femininity, and she may be today's woman. Moving, well, you'll see, let's just see. But Taylor sets up so many layers of ambiguity between men and women and between her and the others. Who sees who is real, who is a memory? It's a very strange piece. The music has so many layers. We hear this pulse. The androgyne in the middle. Same gesture interrupted that we saw in the first movement. She's caught between a man and a woman. The fourth dancer, the woman, runs in a current that catches another element of the music. Anybody to analyze in terms of choreography and in terms of poetic drama and musicality, it would be this second movement of Esplanade. Just as the violin phrase renews itself, in comes another entrance, but now this duet continues between these two women. Mm-hmm. runs around, falls. We're seeing the original cast. This is Betty de Jong, who is to this day the rehearsal mistress for the Taylor Company, but who was a crucial figure from the early days, in the early 60s. This other dancer is the great Carolyn Adams, who danced for Taylor for 20 years. Sense of a protected fall there. The connection between two women who may not even see each other. Fall. Up. Run around. Fall. The fall has a different dynamic each time. Fall. Different kind of drama, where these two women are part of a community now of women, all with one arm folded over the torso, walking up in some strange image of resignation, tender, I think it is grief, each folding to the floor, but moving on. All of it tied into the patterns of the melodic line, both solo violin and orchestra. And you hardly notice that she's the one left alone, that she is the modern one who's been sensing all these figures from the past. Look at that spasm of grief, the contraction. Again. I'm not being pretentious when I say there is grief in this dance. It's there. And then the dancers come on crawling from the wings, on hands and claws, their heads jarred. There are ghosts. Maybe they're animals, and we're making the same Darwinian connection between man and other animals that was there in Cloven Kingdom. And by the way, this crawl on all fours is something that Mark Morris quotes unashamedly, very obviously, in his work V, which is choreographed at Mendelssohn, made in 2001. But I love the way she is merged into the group. So this movement that has seemed about human isolation and sorrow actually ends with something much stranger and more ambiguous than that. Thank you very much. I'm going to end on that note, above all, stressing on you that Taylor is one of the great dramatic poets of choreography, and that to understand the dramatic poetry in his work is to actually find those elements of ambiguity, drama, contrast that is there really in all the great choreographers. He is certainly one. Thank you.